gathered round your grave to grieve. Wish I could see angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice sing. So go rest high.
Good evening, everybody.
Try the other one.
Everything I've done today's been backwards. I got lost. I got to break the ice here because I'm a stranger to some of you and some of you I'm not. So I'm going to kind of break the ice here a little bit and get a little bit comfortable. I've known Donald and Ann for a long time, and I think ever since we were kids, little fellas coming up. I remember one thing about her. She always kind of curled her hair with her finger. And she grew it out of that, though. Thank the Lord. I don't know what caused it. My wife was coming with me today, but she got sick right in the last one, wasn't able to come. So I was supposed to come and say a few words and sing a song. She usually holds the book for me. So I'm going to get Deborah to hold the book today. I didn't plan that before, but anyway. Have her to come and help me in a little bit. And I will sing a song. I'm going to sing a song. It's called Eastern Gate, just inside Eastern Gate. Years ago, there's a lady, me and my wife used to sing at nursing homes and different things like that. And we'd sung over in our area at a family reunion or something. And this one lady, she said, whenever I die, I want y'all to sing at my funeral. So, well, if I'm living, we will. Well, to my age, it was the coldest day that we've had since I've been living in South Georgia. And the wind was blowing about 30 miles an hour. So it come time for us to sing the song. I told my wife, I believe every string on this guitar is going to break because it's so cold. And I said, we'll give it what we got. And I had her stand in front of me so the wind wouldn't blow directly on it. And we made it through it. The Lord blessed us. My fingers froze. I couldn't feel the guitar strings. I just went through the motion. We got there. I was headed here. I came down Riverside. I got down there, and I saw a church down there at the dead end. And there was people there, and they was all leaving. And I was looking at that trying to tell what church it was. And I forgot to see. I didn't even see the sign, Weary Street. So I come this way and turned around and went back. Anyway, so I finally made it. Thank the Lord. And glad to be here. I think it said something about reading a eulogy, but I don't have one. Did y'all have one? You going to do that? You got it?
They just want you to make remarks about it.
Okay. All right. Well, I mean, you know, sometimes we've got the eulogy and tells about the date and all that stuff. So I'll finish trying to make remarks. I said with Ann, and then we grew up. And she always had a little accent that I picked up on. And I finally found out they come from Rome, Georgia. Well, I said, that ain't that far. Why they got an accent? But those people, that's how them people around there talk. And so anyway, I think Ann grew out of it. But they had that. And I remember one of the, you know, new people has new dishes and so forth. Well, I got introduced to gravy and biscuits. And then when I went in the military, I was really introduced to it. But her mom and them used to fix gravy and biscuits for breakfast of the morning. Sometimes they'd have it for lunch and sometimes for supper. If they didn't have much, that's what we had, and that's what they fixed. But they come up, they worked hard. I remember her, Ann's brother, Troy and Leroy. And one time, Troy, they had a little putwood out truck, and the battery was dead on it. He's out in the woods, you know, and you don't have no help and nobody else around hardly. So he takes the chainsaw, takes the blade off of it, takes the belt loose from the alternator off the thing, hooks it to the alternator, puts it on the chainsaw, charges the battery up, cranks up the putwood truck so they can keep on working. So I thought, well, you know, he had to be pretty smart to figure that out. So anyway, I'd been around them a lot and everything. And, of course, Leroy, he was younger than I was. That's Ann's brother. And we did a lot of things together. He was kind of tender-hearted. I killed an old pond scoggin one time, and he ran over and grabbed that thing, was blowing air in his face, trying to revive him to help him make it. I said, I didn't know he was that way about things. And, you know, it kind of got me. I said, well, Lord, if I'd known he was that way, I wouldn't have shot the thing. But anyway, that's some of the times that we had. But with Ann, us growing up, as I said, Ann was my sister-in-law's sister, or her Ann's sister, Christina, married my brother, J.D. And that's how we come up and spending time together and all those years. Like Donald said a while ago, it's been a long time since we'd seen each other. We've been kind of touched bases a little every now and then. I knew Ann been sick. They called me a time or two. I wanted to come and be with y'all then, but I couldn't make it. Then when Deborah called, I was going to come, and then I had an individual that was put in the hospital, so that's where I was at when you called the other day. I was down in the hospital in Jacksonville visiting them. So you know how all that stuff goes. When you need to be able to go somewhere, everything comes apart, and you have to work the best you can. And then beat it all, believe it or not, I was here at 3 o'clock in Waycross. Took me an hour to get here. Not quite. I spent some time doing something else, but we got here anyway. So I was going to sing Rest High on the Mountain. Y'all want to hear it again? I'm going to bypass that one because that's where Vince thinks, amen, they ain't much use to anybody try. But I always liked that song, and I thought it was good with, you know, because of Ann and the situation. I've known them and their family. We've had some hard times and rough times, difficult times, but God saw us through it all. And, of course, I wasn't saved back in those days, you know, but years later, Just in case y'all, I got out of the military in 1970 in April. In 1971, I got saved about a week after Mother's Day. My wife was raised in church. She got, she went back and got saved again. You may not believe in that backsliding stuff, but it's real, I can promise you. And anyway, she went back and dedicated her life to God, and I went to the baptism, and God got a hold of me, and then I wound up and I got saved anyway, 1971. And later on, I spent 13 years in my home church, and then God brought me and called me to preach, and I've been doing that. I've been in my home church now, St. George, for 33 years, and the Lord has blessed us. And I just want to tell you today about that, you know, knowing the fact that Ann and Donald did get in church, and you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior is the most important thing in our life. Amen. I just want to give you just a scripture or two here and tell you why I'm saying this. In the book of John, St. John's, in the very first verse, he said, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." In this day that we're living in, there's nothing, anything real, sure, and true except for God. God never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And His promises never change. What He promised you, He will fulfill it. So that's a comfort that we can get. I do. I pray that you will too. It's a comfort that you can get, that you can trust God with your whole life. You can trust God with everything you got, with your family, everything that you have, because God will not fail you. He's just as real and true with His word. And that's what makes God so mighty. He is true. He's faithful. He's genuine. No changes in Him. What He said, He'll do. And you can depend on it. So I'm thinking about that. We got comfort and hope in the fact that God has sent His Son so we could live again. And we not only just live here in this world, not only have hope in this life, but we can have hope in life eternal. That's my goal. To go be with Jesus, for Paul said, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Now, I can't say whether she's in heaven or hell. That's not my decision. But I know there's a God who loved her so much and loves me and you. And He made a way that we can. God made a way. And He tells us in His word that through faith, amen, we will gain that access through God into the eternal promises that God has for us. So you think about time and how fast time travels. You know, the Bible talks like a vapor. And I look back and it seemed like not too many years ago we were running around playing. Now and then we got up in age and time is closing in. I've gone past the, you know, I'm on borrowed time, they said. Anything over 60 years, you're on borrowed time. So I've been on borrowed time. But that doesn't bother me. Thank God there's something through Jesus Christ. I don't worry about tomorrow. I don't worry about what tomorrow holds because I know who holds tomorrow. I know who made tomorrow. I know who made this world. Matter of fact, I was reading the other day. It just kind of intrigued me. I'm going to share with you. You know, people was asking one time, and they come up with these questions and things. And so the thing was, which one came first, the chicken or the egg? Did any of y'all ever figure it out? Well, I'll tell you, I found it's in the Bible. That's amazing, ain't it? It's in the Bible. In Genesis, first chapter, and I think about 23rd verse there, he said that all the moving creatures and the fowls of the air came from the water. You remember the water? And then the earth came up out of the water and all of those things? Read it, it's in there. He said the fish, every creeping thing come out of the water. But man, God made man in His own image. He made him from the dust of the earth. A lot of answers in the Word. A lot of things in there. And you know what? That's the truth. That truth is what sets us free when it comes to the knowledge of the truth, to know and understand who God is and what God's about. Amen. I'm trying to tell you, He's a great and mighty God. He created all things. And the things that's been made don't really appear, what they appear to be is not what they're really made of. That's why I want to bring that up about that. So And I found so many things in God's Word that gives me that hope and that comfort to know. And I was always kind of felt like I was less than everybody else. I don't know why we came up like that. We were kind of poor. I thought we were poor. But later on in years, I found out we were blessed. And but anyway, just kind of felt like, you know, I was the lowest of any and everybody. And then when I got saved, God brought something to light. I am what I am by the grace of God. I am what I am by the grace of God. And I have a purpose. It doesn't matter to me where I live, no matter where God sends me, where God puts me. I'm happy wherever, as long as I'm serving Him. That's what life, that's really life, is I got a purpose and I got a reason to be here. Some folks might be wished I was gone, but God's glad I'm here, amen? And He'll take me when that time comes. Well, I'm going to try to sing that song. Hey, Deborah, will you come help me? I need somebody prettier than I am up here anyway.
You need some moral support.
Yeah, that's it. That's what. I got to go over here and find that song now because I didn't. I had another guitar that I practiced on yesterday, and bless Pat if the string didn't break on it. I've had the hardest time getting here. So something must be good going to happen. I've learned down through the years, I don't give up. Not when it comes to doing God's work. Amen. Can't ever give in. That's good right there. I will meet you in the morning, just inside. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I would like to pray, and I'll be finished up. Father, as we come today, we need your strength and your help in times like these. But I do want to thank you for your mercy and grace and kindness, God, you bestowed upon us all the days of our life. For without you, we could do nothing. And without you, we are nothing. So, God, today, everyone that's taking part in this service, I pray your anointing, your blessings be poured out on us and help us. And we honor this young lady, the life she's living, the life and the blessings you give her. Even though sickness has touched her body, even all these things we may wrestle with. But God, we know in your hands, everything's all right. Everything's been made whole. Everything's been taken care of. And I thank you for that blessed hope today. And I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm grateful to get to know the Steedley family in more ways than once. And I've had the privilege of knowing a lot of you folks, not just here, but at Faith Temple Church when I was the pastor there all those years ago. And I can't help but think as I stand here today that the wonder of the gospel message is that this is not the end of the line. Amen. This is not the end of the line. Now, for those of you who don't know me, when I preach, it's okay to say amen. This is a Methodist church, but we're not afraid of amens here. And if you want to have a glory hallelujah once in a while, that'll be all right too, okay? Amen? All right. Now, just let me know you're with me and you're not sleeping, okay? It was kind of humorous. Usually you don't try to be humorous at funerals, although that seems to be a gift God's given me. To find the humor at this time of our lives. We were at the hospital, and when I walked in, Donald was introducing me to everybody, and he said, "We like D's in our family." And if you've got this obituary, it says, "Donald, Daryl, Dana, Donnie, David, Dalton, Dusty, Destin, Dylan, Desire, and Dwayne." I'm Dwayne on top of all that. So I must be part of the family, Brother Donald. And it was a privilege to be able to share with Donald and his most immediate family those last moments of this precious woman's life. One of the things I've known for sure is that Donald loved his wife. And you say amen to that. You all saw that obvious, didn't you? And Donald, I'll just tell you this. I couldn't tell you while she was still with us, but she told me more than once she wished you'd leave her alone for about 5 minutes. And the last day I was there, when you went out and got me the cabbage and the rutabagas, she put me up to that. Yeah, when you weren't paying attention, she said, "He's got some rutabagas out there. You like rutabagas?" Yeah, well, take him out in the garden for a little while. So that's what that was all about. And by the way, that was the good cabbage. We had some good slaw 2 or 3 days in a row. That cabbage head that big goes a long ways for 3 people. And enjoyed that and appreciated it. And Don was telling us a little bit about how much he loved his wife. And he looked right at her and pointed and said, "That's the prettiest woman I ever met in my life." And then he wanted me to see a picture of her the day after they met. And he went through this litany of things that she was capable of, and that reason he loved her so much. And he said, "She always had my clothes washed. I'd come in from work, she'd have my meal on the table and something for me to drink." And he said, "She was just good about that, and I didn't have to hit her once." Now, we knew he was kidding. That don't seem to be the kind of thing you would say about your wife, you know, especially here in the South, because there's some folks that do that, live that way. But we all knew the funny part about it was if he ever hit her, it'd be the last time he hit anybody. She was a spitfire now. And we just thank the Lord for the opportunity to get to know the family. And, of course, Christy married Steedley and known Christy since she was a pup, and her mom and family. And we're just glad to have you all here. That's what this is all about. It's saying farewell to Ann. But when our son died, somebody gave me a little image of a ship that was sailing away, and it was titled, This is Death. And this essence of the story, and the author did such a better job than I can do by memory right now, is that in those final moments of our life, this ship raises its sail and it turns away from us and it begins to sail off into the horizon. And as it goes off into the horizon, it grows smaller and smaller and smaller. If you've ever been at a port city and watched the ships come and go, you know they seem to disappear and get smaller into the horizon. And the author said the ship is no smaller in its spar or in its weight or in its cargo. It hasn't changed a bit, but it's changed from our vision. And as we're saying goodbye and it goes over the horizon, there are folks on the other side. We're saying, there she goes. And they're saying, here she comes. Amen. Now, the Word of God, I want to share some of the Word of God with you in just a second about how we can be sure of what transpires when a believer leaves this world, because that's so important to every single one of us that are here today. And I would assume you're here because you cared about Donald and his family and about Ann. I would assume that would be the reason that you were here today. And the essence of Christianity teaches us that there's only one thing we can take out of this world. People. Relationships. That's all we'll take out of this world. That's all that we'll be reunited with when this world comes to its end. The things of this world will pass away. The scripture even talks about a new heaven and a new earth. I'm not sure I understand all of what that imagery is, but I've got things in my life that I like. I've got an old pickup truck that I've had forever. My kids grew up in it. I got an old Z28 that all three of my kids drove to high school, and I still love to fire it up and smell that carburetor, smell that you get when you start up an old V8 engine. But it's going to be somebody else's when I leave this world. My house, all that. The only thing I got to take out of this world is y'all. And I can just hope that I've invested somewhere along the way in the life of some of you that are sitting here today so that when I get to heaven, the Lord say, there's a jewel in your crown. But every single one of you have that option and opportunity as well. You invest in the lives of other people and you teach them this gospel message. That gospel message is just that simple. It's the same. And, you know, the world that we live in is full of trouble. It's just full of trouble. If you watch the news much, if you look around you in your own life, in our lives here, it was just a few weeks ago that Ann sat right there on the third row, insisted on coming here to vote with the church on an important issue that we were voting on as a church. And I was amazed that she was here and sat through that hour-long session. But she was determined that she was going to do that. Today, she's in heaven. And I had the privilege of seeing faith in action in the life of Brother Donald. And I just hope the younger folks, those of you that are younger here today, can grasp the reality of this. When you believe in Jesus, Jesus said, as I am, you will be. And that was in his resurrected body. The scripture teaches us that he came out of the ground and he said, touch me. I'm not a spirit. I'm not a ghost. And in his resurrected body, he said, you're going to be like this. And that's what the New Testament teaches us, that we're going to be like Jesus when we come out of that grave. And as we were there with Anne, and she was breathing her last breaths, and I've had the opportunity 50 times now in my pastoral ministry to be with family and friends as they leave this world. And this was the most gentle, quietest passing from this life to the next that I've ever seen in my life. And Donald's leaning over her as she's leaving her body in this world. And Jesus said to be absent from the flesh is to be present with the Lord. That's what the New Testament teaches. So Donald looks around and he says, she's not here anymore. She's with Jesus. Amen. What a testimony to leave for his son and the folks that were standing in that room with him. He believes that moment, she's not in that old body that was wore out, that was sick, that she was laboring with and laboring over all these years, but she's with Jesus. Amen? And here's the wonder of it. For believers, Jesus said, they that believe in me, shall, though they die, yet shall they live again. And the New Testament says to be absent from the flesh is to be present with the Lord. The Apostle Paul said that this body is like a grain of wheat. You have to put it into the ground. It has to die in order for it to have the life that God wants us to have, which is eternal life. We quote John 3:16 all the time. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believed in him would not perish, but what? Have everlasting life. Everlasting life. That's the promise that Jesus gave us. But in order to have that everlasting life, which is what comes next, we have to do something. It requires something on our part. And God, in my understanding of Scripture, does not predestine you to heaven or hell. He lays out the options in front of you and says, here they are. Here's my son. John says, this is the condemnation, that light came into the world, and you loved darkness instead of light. Somebody asked me, you think Jesus is really going to send people to hell? And my immediate response is, no, Jesus isn't going to send anybody to hell. You decide to reject Jesus. And the Bible says, Jesus himself, his own words, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And I saw some people in a debate this last week were discussing the issue of by what authority do you say Christianity is the way and it's the only way to be reconciled to God. And you're not supposed to argue from the point of authority. But the reason America and the reason churches in America are in the predicament we're in right now with the animosity and the hatred and the moral corruption that we're seeing is because people have thrown the Bible away and said it is not an authority. In my understanding and estimation, I've discovered the Bible is the final authority on all things in human life in this world. Amen? It's the final authority. And Jesus said, that's not Pastor Dwayne's opinion. That's not Oprah Winfrey's opinion, thank God. It is the Bible's opinion. Amen? It's the Word of God. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. He who would come any other way is a thief and a robber. That's what the Word of God says. You say, why is that so important? Because when we come to this place, and we all will come to this place, life is filled with hard things. And we all will come to this place. If you're here today and you haven't lost someone close to you and intimate to you, you're the exception because that's a part of being in this life. For some people, life is almost like a torture chamber. They're in agony all the time. We're not anywhere near that. I hear people grumbling all the time. And yeah, gas is high and all these things. The economy is not like we'd like for it to be. And yeah, there's immorality all around us. But there are folks who died today for the sake of their belief in Jesus. We've got it good. In my opinion, we live in the best part of the world, the best nation in the world, the best state in the world, and the best part of the South in the world because this is still the Bible Belt. And everywhere you go, you find people that believe in Jesus. And that's the reason we have a sane society, and we're losing that because people have lost the sense of the authority of the Word of God. Why is that important? Why is it relevant? Because every single one of you that are here today has somebody with you that you care about. See that person sitting next to you? I'm not being morbid. This is just in memory of Ann and what I saw with Donald and Ann in those last few moments of their life. That's the reality of where life's going to take us all. And the only hope that we have when we come to the end of this life that we'll take those relationships or have those relationships after we die is if we believe on the Son of God named Jesus. Amen? That's our only hope. And there may be someone here who has never made that decision. You may have never said, I believe Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that he died for my sins. I repent of those sins and I invite him into my heart and life. You can do that. It takes a prayer, a very personal prayer. Not something I tell you to do, but something you do and invite Christ to come into your heart and life. And when you say, make him Lord of your life, you're not doing anything except surrendering to what he already is. And he came out of the grave, the Bible says, that all power was given unto him whereby men might be saved. So he has that power. He has the power to save. You have to cry out to him and call on him. I do not apologize for offering that opportunity to you today. Not long ago, I was asked by a family at a funeral of a young man who had died from a horrible sickness to not force people to make a choice between God and any other religion. And I said, well, I can do that because I don't force people to make a choice anyway. If you know about Jesus and you don't accept him, you've already rejected him. Amen. And that's the condemnation. The Word of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ offers us so much hope. It's hope in this life, because when Jesus came, he sent the Holy Spirit to be with us and to help us, and we pray that the Holy Spirit's going to be with Brother Donald over these next few days. Brother Donald, I'm praying you'll sense God's presence in your life like you've never sensed it before, because I don't have the words to take away the pain of your emptiness over these next few days and months. The rest of you that have been around Ann all this time, I don't have the words to take that away, but God's presence can come into your heart and into your life, and you'll be able to go through those things and endure that emptiness until God fills that void in your life with his Spirit and his presence. And sometimes I'm not so sure, but what God doesn't take people out of our life so that we'll let him have his proper place in our lives. Is everything that God does, everything that God allows in our lives, is to draw us into a deeper relationship with him. The final analysis is, y'all, this life is a testing ground. That's all it is. We're not created for this world the way it is. Adam and Eve weren't created for a world full of sin. They were put into a perfect world. Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not true, I would not have told you. He said, I go away to prepare a place for you, and as surely as I go away, I will come again. Amen? There are over 100 references in the Word of God that indicate to us that we're going to be reunited with our loved ones. Even in the Old Testament, that is a reoccurring theme, and it says Joseph died and went to his people. Three times in the book of Genesis, or the book of Exodus, it makes that comment about biblical characters dying and going to their people. What do you think that means? Some people say, oh, that just means they went in the grave. That's not what Jesus said. On the Mount of Transfiguration, Jesus appeared to his followers, and guess what? There were two Old Testament characters who had been dead hundreds of years that stood on the mountain with him. Now, brother, they were living beings, weren't they? They were living beings. Now, that was Old Testament characters before Jesus died on the cross and paid the price for our redemption. And if he was able to bring back those two from the Old Testament, guess what? I am firmly convinced, based on two passages of Scripture, that our loved ones see the good things that are happening in this life and rejoice over it. The Word of God teaches us that God has sent his angels to minister to the people of God. Hath not God sent all of his angels as ministering spirits to them that are the heirs of salvation? That's the King James translation of that verse. Hath not God sent all of his angels as ministering spirits? So where are the angels? If they're ministering to those who are the heirs of salvation, where are the angels? They're here now, in our presence. So who's overlooking the banister of heaven rejoicing? Who's the great cloud of witnesses? It's the people who've already gone before us. There's great rejoicing in heaven when someone comes to faith in Christ. Amen. There isn't anything, as painful as it is, that doesn't filter through God's love for us. And Donald, much as you love that woman, God loved her more. Much as she loved you, God loves you more. You got a family around you. And God's left you here to continue to set the example that you have set up to this time of faith in Jesus so that they all come in. That's God's call on every father, every grandfather, every mother, every one of you that have friends. God's call on you is to go into the world and preach the gospel. And this brother and I have been called to preach, but we're not the only preachers. The Word of God is the power of God unto salvation. You've heard the Word of God. You know the Word of God. And there are people in this world that need that Word. Amen? Jesus still saves. Amen? He still transforms. Amen? He still gives eternal life. Amen? Amen. And that's what this world is for. And I guarantee you, Brother Donald, there's more than 7 or 8 or 9 D's when we get to heaven. I think it'd be just curious, won't it, just to say, okay, all you with the name D, line up over here and let's get acquainted. Wouldn't that be neat? I don't know exactly what heaven's going to be like. There are a number of opinions, and scholars disagree just about what that is. But this wonderful passage in the Old Testament says, a lion's going to lay down by the lamb. The lion's going to lay down by the lamb, what? And people will be going in and out of God's holy city day and night. That sounds like people being busy. And when I was growing up, I thought, when I get to heaven, I'm going to sit up on a cloud up there somewhere and play a harp. The bad thing is, I'm jealous of you because I can't play a stringed instrument for nothing in the world. Try it. I got a guitar in there, but it's just rote memory. So I'm not going to be too good at playing a harp if that's all there's going to be when we get to heaven. But there's going to be much, much more than that. And the best part of it is the relationships that we're going to keep and continue. So I would say it again. If you're here today and you haven't invited Christ to be Lord of your life, repented of your sins, today's as good a day as any to do that. And if you're here with people you love, when you die, they're going one way and you're going the other. Amen. It's wonderful to be able to serve in this capacity as pastor of this church with this family and to see God's presence and His Spirit at work. This is the gospel message. This is the gospel message in action. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? Amen. I believe with all my heart we're going to see each other again when we leave this world. Amen. Let's pray. Father, before we share this last song today, I pray you'd touch the hearts of everyone here and remind folks that there's only one way to take these loves of our life with us, and that's to be in a relationship with your Son, Jesus. He's the only way. He's the solution. He's the answer. He's the hope. And in Him, we can resolve all of the disagreements and put them aside and say, nothing but the blood, nothing but the blood, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and stay, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow. Oh, precious is the flow, that crimson flow that washes us white as snow. Lord, thank you for the blood of your Son. Let us cast our belief and our faith in Him. And truly, hold tight to the relationships that we have in this world by turning loose of them and holding on to your nail-scarred hand. We love you today, Lord. Bless this family. May your Spirit minister in this dark time. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.